Good afternoon, fellow students. Welcome to the subject Educational Research 2 for the course Bachelor of Education Honours Degree. My name is Lucas Kahare as a tutor for this subject, and I'm going to talk about examination for next year, 2020. So this presentation will cover us for all three examinations. That's examination in April, August, and also in November. So please pay attention. And this presentation is very much important. And I made sure that I compiled a proper presentation with some main facts. So you are welcome and pay attention. Thank you. Unit contents that you need to focus more. You know that the study guide for educational research too has 19 units, I think. Yes, yeah, it is big. It's introduction. It basically focus on quantitative research and qualitative research, and they are different. And there are difference within those research and how to carry out those research. And there are many some facts under those sub main topics. So, as written, focus more on these units, unit 1, 3, 6, 7, 8, 11, 13, 19. Okay? That's just a layout, okay? I'm just trying to help you how you should learn, just how you should limit, how you should use your time effectively for you to achieve your goal. And also, you can also read more about unit 2, 5, 9, 10, 12, 14, 17, 18. Okay? Unit 1 is about research characteristics. And here, talk about what's a research, the importance of research, how to use research, the limitation of research. So that is in unit 1. And those are just some of the facts, which are like the definition of research. Research is a systematic process of collecting and analyzing data for some purposes. Yes, should be a system or a process in which you have to gather information, okay? So first you have to plan how to get those informations, and you go and get those informations. And how can you work with, how are you going to use those information, okay? That is okay, converting them from one form to another, and all until you produce the final project. And in this one, you have to use methodology. And this methodology, we talk about quantitative or qualitative and experimental and systematic and so on. And there are also some limitations of research. So research can be also limited in some areas. There are something which limit research. So if you want to do research, and so it's not... You know, you have to get permission, okay? For example, maybe if you want to go and find out maybe the life of certain community, okay? Maybe you want to do research, okay? How the life changed in certain community. Yes, you have to maybe to go and get permission, maybe to the leader of that community, for you to carry out your research. You can't just go and do it, okay? Maybe if you want to take out the study, in the department, maybe in your teaching department, maybe at a regional councillor, maybe you have a topic. So you have to go and get permission that, please, I want to introduce the director and all that. So there are some limits. So now the limit can be ethical concern or institutional nature of education, program variability. So, for example, maybe if you want to make to research on certain things in the country, maybe those... program is not available in the country, so it's very difficult for you to carry on research. Okay, so for example, maybe you want to carry out the research on nuclear manufacturing, okay, in Namibia. So do we have nuclear things, okay, processing in Namibia? We don't have, so you can't carry the research in Namibia. Okay, maybe you can only carry a research maybe uranium extraction, maybe at roasting mine, yes, you can. So there are something. So that's also one of the limits. Research characteristics. The importance of educational research. So why is educational research is important? Okay? So, you know, research, now they add educational. So we are talking about educational research, okay? A research which focused on improving education system, okay, in particular. Okay? So the model of education is like education help educators understand educational process, make professional decision, and also educational research provide information to policy group to assist them with mandated change in education. Okay, there are some educational policymakers. So in this one, if they want to make policymakers, so they go and view the published papers in education, because there are many papers that are published in education. So these policymakers or even educators, for them to understand the system, yes, they may go and read papers for the in the education research, and so on. Function of research. Research functions. Function of research, here I'm going to talk, as you see, there are Venn diagrams, they overlap. They know that they should be overlap, they should work together, okay? The applied research, basic research, evaluation research, and action research. So this is in unit one. Okay, applied research, you know, that research must be applied for, I mean, practical one. Maybe if you see, but maybe the education system, maybe in your region or at your school is not performing. So you go there and evaluate why is something happening like that. And action research, evaluation research, basic research, so they are also there. So I'm not going to spend much time because I'm just given a few minutes, and these are unity up to unit 19. So just know those one, what is applied research or basic research, evaluation research, and action research. Comparison of qualitative and quantitative research. So you have to be able to compare quantitative and qualitative research. Okay. Aim of qualitative analysis is complete detailed description about, and then quantitatives actually, yes, you can use, like, you know, you collect information, you analyze them, and then you represent them. Okay, that is quantitative. And they actually applied in science, and qualitative probably in social science. Yes, in yours also, you can choose quantitative or qualitative research. So, and those are just detailed difference. Unit 2 is research design and evaluation of research. So unit 1 we talked about, in unit 1 we talked about characteristics, what is research and what is the importance of research and their function. But here now, how can you design research and evaluate? So the definition of research design. I'd say that research design is the set of methods and the procedure used in collecting and analyzing measure of the variable specified in the problem research. So that's taken with Wikipedia. So this one, research design, for example, now if you, you come up with your topic, then you said, okay, I'm going to use qualitative research or quantitative research. Now you are having with your research design. So you are going to use that research methodology for analysis in your research. Okay? There are four categories of research design, like quantitative, which can be divided into experimental and non-experimental design. So this is, I say that in quantitative, say using numbers or statistics analysis and so forth to analyze your information or data into physical presentation. Okay, you count, for example, you count the number of female and male in your class, or maybe that passed grade 10, so you enter them into a computer using statistical analyzers, then you draw some graphs, present it. That is quantitative and Qualitative, yes, you can just start with a description that, yes, the number of students, the number of female and male students who pass grade 10 is this and this in this region. The reason is this, this, this. So, you know, the school become, and then maybe you go there and just interview and some few individual teachers. So that would be a qualitative research. And also mix research too, and analytical design. Analytical design, you go the analytical research, you go the why things happen like that. Okay, you find the answer, why things, so you go further and analyze more ideas. Research types. Design of the non-experimental research types. This is a quantitative research now. There's a design of non-experimental research types like descriptive, comparative, correlational, survey, expo, factor and secondary data analysis. So just know those ones and what are they. Please, or we don't have that much time there. Design of analytical method research types like policy analysis, concept of analysis, and historical analysis. Unit 3, research questions and hypotheses. Here now, when you are doing research, you come up why, okay, you, so, some questions and why you are doing this research and what do you want and then from there your findings. So a research hypothesis refers to the relationship or the absence of between two or more variables that the researcher is interested in. A null hypothesis is when we hypothesize that there will be no difference between groups, no consistent relationship between variables, or more generally, no pattern in the data. So the other one, hypothesis, if you are interested to find the relationship, okay, between two variables, okay, maybe you are saying that maybe the pass rate of female and male of grade 10, so you want to differentiate, and then null hypothesis, you don't need difference there. So there's no difference between these two groups, these two variables. Hypothesis is one of that stat three is statistically significant relations between two variables. Or the formulation of research problems and the research questions for mixed methods research. This is unit three still. Yes, research question and hypothesis, unit three. Yes, quantitative research question or hypothesis use terms like describe, compare, relate. So just you read also unit three, and also to differentiate what are research questions for quantitative research and also qualitative research. And analyzes the features. And unit four is about research literature. So there also many this question also come there is the purpose of research literature review. Why should you maybe you come up with a topic, but you have to go read more information. What others have published on that research or on that topic. Or maybe about on a failure rate, or maybe based on maybe gender violence, what others has published. So you go and get some knowledge. So this is very much important, literature review. Primary and secondary source for literature review. Primary and secondary source for literature review. So that you should know what is a primary source and what is a secondary source, okay? And give an example, okay? That is where you just have to focus on that one. You are able to describe or define a primary source, give an example, okay? That is what you have to focus on this unit. And I think it is clear that a primary source are, for example, original documents such as diaries, speeches, manuscript, and so on. You know, the first one, okay? And maybe dissertation, and so on. Those are primary source, okay? And the secondary source, like book review, okay? You are reviewing a book, that's a secondary source. For example, secondary source describes summaries or discuss information or detail originally presented in another source. Okay, there's a you. It's another source. The primary source is already published, and then you just, information being taken from primary source to be represented by it. So that is a secondary resource, sources. And also note the strength and weakness of internet searches. So information available, what is the strength and the weakness of using internet search? So that is also very much important. You should know that one. It's clearly, okay? It's very clearly stated there. You can read current need access to educational research from many other countries, offer beyond journal, article, and research. So you can get more information using internet and, you know, you can get information from maybe governmental information. So, you know, because there are a lot of database of information, so on the internet, okay? Or sometimes, so you end up that the information is not accurately reviewed by, and so forth. Unit 5 is quantitative research design. Okay, design of quantitative research. So as I said, different between qualitative and quantitative. So this is a quantitative, using maybe computer to design with the help of the software and so on. Okay, and analysis of four principal design validity in quantitative research. Research must know constructive validity, internal validity, external validity, and statistical or conclusion validity. So just know those ones. And the unit 6, dimension of quantitative designs, participant, subject, and samplings. The difference between a unity of study and unity of analysis. Okay, that one is always there, please know. For example, unity of study, phenomena or participant or subject or object upon which the study or experiment are carried out. Okay, that is a unit of study. So you are going to do a study. So there are some, a topic maybe on people, what maybe on certain topic or on certain object, maybe you are going to do study of a human body. Okay, so maybe unit of study, your unit of study is a human body. So, and then a unit of analysis is the major entity that is being analyzed in study. It's what or how that is being studied. So, for example, a unit of analysis. Now you have your studies about a human body, and then you will be, what do you want to study on a human body? Maybe you want to know, so how the human body works. So maybe the types or different parts of a human body, that is analysis. Okay, you are breaking it now into parts for you to analyze. Okay, that is a unity of analysis. Population and sample, probability and non-probability sampling. What is sampling? Sampling is a research study. Research study is the selection of participants from the entire population. A population is a complete set of people with a specialized set of characteristics. And sample is a subset of the population. Okay? Yes. A sample, when we talk about a population sample, which means when you take just one variable or individual from the many to study about it. So then if you find the characteristic of that one, then you know that, okay, if this thing's having this characteristic, then that group has this characteristic also. That is a sample. Okay? For example, when even Yes, in research, maybe they want to analyze, maybe you want to analyze that, that is maybe in agriculture, so you analyze maybe the soil. So a fertile soil, a good soil that you want maybe to grow plants. So what the agriculturalist or scientist do that they take the soil and take it just a part of the soil and go and analyze it. So if they find out that, oh, this soil is a loam soil and very fertile, which means they know from that sample, they know that, yes, the whole area of that have the same characteristic of, like, that sample. So now they consume that, okay, at this area, there's a good soil. Or even they take a sample, for example, in the mining area, where if they are finding if there's a diamond or no diamond, or there's gold, so they go and take some sample of stones and so on, and take them to the library and analyze. So if they find out, which means that area has that resources. So that is a sample. Just individual parts of the group to be examined on. That is sampling. And type of probability and non-probability sampling. Sampling can be probability sampling or non-probability sampling. Okay, that is a probability sampling, like random sampling, like simple random sampling, systematic random sampling, stratified random sampling, cluster random sampling. Or convenience non-random, non-probability sampling, quota non-probability sampling, and purposeful non-probability sampling. So those are just an example that you should just read on what those sampling means. And unit 7 is a descriptive statistics. Yes, this I said is, or this is also part of the quantitative research. Descriptive statistics and inferential statistics. As you know that descriptive is you know, to describe. So descriptive statistics uses mathematical techniques in the identification of pattern in the data by organizing, summarizing, and visualizing the meaning of the distribution of the values. Measure of central tendency, amount of variability, extent to which different variables. So descriptive, for example, if you we talk about descriptive statistics to describe using numbers, mathematical, or using which ones, let's say, or like in your class, they have written a test, you give them a test, maybe out of 100, then you calculate maybe if there are 10 students or 20 students, and then, you know, you list their marks, and from there you find out, okay, how many got, for example, maybe 60%, 60 and 70, how many of the students? Maybe you find that maybe it's 10. Okay, how many, maybe, for example, 50, okay? Then you find that number. So that is what now the median between the low and the high. And the mode is the number that appear more. And from there, you can now draw a graph, okay? Okay? A graph to indicate, like from this mark, from maybe 60, maybe 60 to 69, the number of students who got this is maybe 5 or 10. From 70 to 79, maybe the number of students who got this is maybe 8, and so on. So this is you are describing the statistic using mathematical representation. That is statistical, that is descriptive statistics. Inferential statistics allow us to use information obtained from sample to draw conclusion about population. Okay, this is just inferential statistics, probably just getting the information which has been taken from somewhere, and then statistically analyze, draw the conclusion that, okay, from this one, maybe 5% of the student pass, and from this all, so you are doing inferential statistics. So, and also know the purpose. Inferential statistics are to estimate population parameters, example, the value of population, mean, to test hypotheses, suggestion, assumption variables, and so on. Function of graphical portrayal of data. So the graphical, like the representation of information on a graph. The function of measure of central tendency is to indicate the average score An example may include the mean, mode, and median. Function of measure of variable is to show the difference between the score of distribution, how they are spread, scattered, thus dispersion of score. An example may include range and standard deviation. The function of measure of relationship is to measure the extent to which two or more variables are related, associated. Example may include scatter plot or scatter diagram, the Peterson product moment correlation, the Spearman correlation coefficients, or the Phi correlation coefficients. So this graphical portrayal of data is to show the central, for example, what are the influence, you know, the statistically to show on a graph. So you just see it on the next. So that is an example of that. So if you can see here, histogram representing the frequency distribution. Okay. Let me say, this is interval, class intervals, max class interval. For example, the frequency 41 and 50, this is the frequency appear, the frequency more of that between that, okay, is 4. And 51 and 60, those got maybe 51 and 60 to between this one, 7, the 7, and then from this one, you represent now, okay, the interval of the max, and here the frequency. So you see that 41 and 50 is 4, so you draw up to where it is here, 4. And 51 to 60, you draw the bar graph up to here, and so on and so on. So these are just simple. I think most of these, yes, it's also part of, maybe in your assignment here, you'll be given this table to draw, okay, to represent it in histogram. Either you are given histogram presentation to come up with a distribution, frequency distribution table. So I don't think this is difficult. So you see that this form and the 36 class frequency 36 and so on. So the collection of quantitative data. How are you collecting of quantitative data now to collect? So you are decided to use a quantitative research methodology. So how are you going to get to, okay? Tests used for collecting data on learner proficiency. You can use paper and pen test, standardized test, NUM and criterion reference test, aptitude test, achievement test. Okay, those all you can use learner proficiency, how they are. So you can, based on the achievement, those who achieve better, aptitude test, you give them just a test for them to test who got better and low marks and so on. NUM and criterion according to their criterias, okay, group them into criteria, how, and standardized test, standards, so which means all of them, they must just do the standard evaluation and so on. Advantage and limitation of using performance-based testing or portfolio as means of alternative assessment. Okay, you must know type of assessment, advantages and limitations. These are the performance-based assessment and portfolio assessment. You must know this one, advantage and limitation of performance-based assessment. This is context authentic, holistic measure of thinking skills. Skill performance in context, criterion referenced without constraints of written test closely tied to instructions. And here, portfolio, systematic collection of many examples of learners' work and can evaluate growth or change. So this is a portfolio, just you can ask questions who they are and different works that they do is this portfolio, but here's performance, based on performance, on the skills the learner possess. So they are, those are advantage and limitation of using performance-based testing or portfolio as a mean of alternative assessments, okay? So please know the type of assessment, performed-based assessment and portfolio assessment in this case. steps in constructing an interview. So now you want to construct an interview. Here is a part of quantitative. So you must just do justification, define your objective or write questions, what you are going to ask, design in general item format and pre-testing. Just do that. And these are advantages and limitations of using interview in quantitative research. So please know this. They are very much important. Advantage of interview and limitation of interview. So flexible and adaptable techniques, the potential, subjective and bias. So all just know this, the difference. It's also important. Advantage of using online survey. Yes, online survey, you know that this is using what? Internet to survey, to find out. So online survey are accessible and most targeted audience. Online panels available for purchase are better quality than ever and other inexpensive accesses to many qualified people, meeting the audience where they are and so on. They are usually non-cost-based geographical restriction. Leverage and data automation, example, input, handling, analytics, and reporting. So these are just online survey. And also there are disadvantages of using online survey. No. Okay, that's like poorly chosen distribution channel can lead to biased data, low response rate, and host other potential issues. And participants are less likely to stay full engaged for a survey of more than 8 to 8 minutes than with other research methods. So these are part of the, just know the survey. Advantage and various way of survey administration, type of survey, postal, internet, and telephone, if you survey. So these are just one of the things that you advantage and the disadvantage. Let's also know them. Unit 10, experimental research. Okay, experimental research is part of quantitative research method in which conditions are controlled so that one or more independent variable can be manipulated to test hypotheses about dependent variables. So this experiment, so you are able to control the conditions. So it's a master experiment used also in the technical fields. So allow evaluation of causal relationship among variable while all other variables are eliminated or controlled. Experimental validity. To validate, indicate internal validity and external validity. Internal validity indicate whether the independent variable was the sole cause of the change in the dependent variable. External validity indicate the extent to which the result of the experiment are applicable to the real world. And also threat to internal validity. So you know this one, threat to internal validity relevant to the single group post-test only design, historically, instrumentation, experimental subject. So, and also in threat to internal validity. So those one also know them. And chapter 7 is inferential data. Okay. That is, we're done with descriptive statistics, and here's inferential data. Okay, inferential statistic inference is the process of using data analysis to deduce property of underlying probability distributions. Inferential statistics analyzes infer property of population, for example, by testing hypotheses and deriving estimate. Describe data. For example, chart, graph, and inferential statistics allow you to make prediction inferences from that data. Okay, so that's now, this is descriptive, inferential data, not a descriptive data. So inferential data is allow you to make a conclusion from the information given, from the statistical information given. Feature of the null and alternative hypotheses. The first stage in any quantitative data analysis after producing a graphical display of the data is to calculate measure of variability and measure of central tendency for the data. Second measure of function of inferential statistics is the testing of hypotheses. So here now you have to, after doing a presentation, that is a descriptive study, then you have to calculate a measure of variability, how the data are being distributed across the graph, whereas you calculate the variance and the mean. So this is a null and alternative hypotheses. Two hypotheses, a null hypotheses and alternative hypotheses. So know them, two types of hypotheses, null hypotheses and alternative hypotheses, stating no difference or correlation. Null hypotheses, there is no difference or no correlation, that does not relate or does not, the data do not correlate. And alternative hypotheses, according to this May 28 publication, the alternative hypotheses can be either non-directional or directional between these one. Okay, that they don't have in the same common or they go along. Non-directional is also called two-sided test, and simply mean not equal to the null hypotheses. Okay. Non-directional is also called a two-sided test, and simply means that they're not equal to the null hypotheses, because null hypotheses is there is no difference, okay, and here is non-directional, which means they don't go along, so which means it's not equal to null hypotheses, okay? Because in null hypotheses, there's no difference of data. And directional alternative hypotheses indicate either greater than or less than. So you can conclude that either the data is, this one's greater than or less than. So you can see statistical notation of hypotheses, non-directional or non-zero correlation, okay? This one, hypotheses is zero, and this one is not equal to zero. So that's non-directional, directional, greater than, or positive correlation. Okay, this is equal to zero, but this one's greater than. But there is different. Here, not equal. Here is equal, but this one greater than, or this one less than. Directional, less than, or negative correlation. This is negative correlation, less than. P is less than zero. This is negative correlation, and P is greater than zero, positive correlation. In other words, directional hypotheses is positive correlation, and this is a directional, and a non-directional, it means that P is equal to zero or P not zero. Okay, time is not with me. Okay, let me just move up. Type 1 and type 2 errors. Okay, please know this one. Type 1 and type 2 error in interpreting the value of significant of the null hypotheses. A type 1 error is the rejection of true null hypotheses, also known as a false positive finding or conclusion, while type 2 error is the failure to reject a false null hypothesis, known as false negative finding or conclusion, okay? So which means type 1 error, if you look at here, type 1 error is directional, greater, which means positive. Type 2 error is negative correlation, okay? So look at here, positive correlation and the negative correlation. So a small p indicates that the probability of the result, occurring under the null hypothesis, which means that the observed finding, the result of the chance alone, is small. So which means that when you have the value of p is small, indicates that the probability of the result of the null hypothesis is too small, and the smaller p indicate that they reject of the favor of the alternative hypotheses. Okay, and they also know single sample t-test and two sample tests. You know three types of tests, know this one. Three types of tests: single sample test, independent simple t-test, and pair t-test. Okay, and please know them also. What is there? And ANOVA of the null hypotenuse, these are just using ANOVA software and list variance and used in differentiate the score when there is no more than two independent groups. Parametric and non-parametric test, also know that one. So please know this one also. 12, since we don't have time, the phase of data collection, the design of qualitative research. So here now, the qualitative research now. Okay, not using statistical data. Step one, know the phases of data collection of qualitative research. Step one is the planning. Step two, beginning data collection. You plan what to do. Then you go and collect the data. You are beginning to collect the data now. And step three, basic data collection. Some of the basic of the data that you collected. And step four, closing data collection. So you are done with the data collection. Then you complete your data collection. Okay, then from there you code and find out what is your research all about. Ethic in qualitative research. There are some ethics. This principle of larger degree correspond with the research ethics fieldwork. They include the principle of autonomy and respect, all this. So just know that one bit, so we don't need to waste time on that. So come to this one, it's very much important. UD3, 13, collection of qualitative data. Five major data gathering techniques for qualitative studies are observation, interview, questionnaire, document review, and audio-visual recording. So this is very much important. Please know that one. And the interview, types of interview, personal interview, telephone interview, also know that one. Advantage and disadvantage of using film and photography of in data collection, you also know this one also. Data analysis, yes. Reason for using inductive analysis style is a study include condensing extensive variety raw materials into brief summary format, establishing the link between objective of the study and the summary finding derived from the that. Also know this one, unit 14. So please, but know this one, steps in analyzing qualitative data. Know that one's very much important. Steps in analyzing analyzing qualitative data, collection of data, organization of data, transaction. You know, these are steps. First, collect the data, organize it, transcript it, code the data, describe the data, categorize the data, and discovering the pattern. So this one, please know that one. Very much important. Using electronic computer in qualitative data. This is very much important. So pay attention to this. Read this one. Advantage of using electronic computer in qualitative data analysis. So easier to work with amount of data, easier to store and organize, easier to search and locate segment, retrieval of data, easy software can analyze. So these are very much important. Please know this advantage of using computer. And the disadvantage of using electronic alternative in also know why it's not good using computer as a source of research, of quantitative research. You must learn the software. Sometimes it takes time, or you know, and also the skill of computer is difficult, and so forth. And also, it will make you depend on using computer, so you will not able to go there, and you will just depend on using internet to find out what's the information without you going directly physically and maybe interview people and so on. So you will depend on the information on the internet. That is what was one of the disadvantages. 15, mixed method research design. So this mixed method research design, which means qualitative and quantitative. Mixed method research is a methodology of conducting research that involve collecting, analyzing, collecting, you collect, you analyze, integrating quantitatives, okay? Example, experiment, survey, and qualitative focus groups, interview and research. These are now combination now of quantitative and qualitative research is mixed research. Please know also advantage and disadvantage of mixed research, which is not listed there. And also mixed method research sampling. Discuss four types of sampling in mixed method research. So this is very much important. So it's clear even there. So this presentation is very much. You must know stratified purposeful sampling, purposive random sampling. Yes, we discussed already from the sampling there. Okay, so what sampling and the type of random sampling and non-random sampling. We discussed also, four or five there. So please know this. And concurrent triangulation sampling. You name them and then you discuss them. Okay. Chapter 16, Unit 16 is analytical research. Okay. We said that there are four research, type of research methodology, qualitative we started with, and then quantitative, then mixed you are done, then here is analytical research. Purpose of analytical research, you must know the purpose of analytical research is a research to establish through qualitative equal why something is the way it is or how it can to be. So know that one. And factor influencing accuracy and competence in qualitative, also know that one. And also at 17, please know evaluation research and policy, like purpose of evaluation research. Should know that one. And the difference between formative and summative evaluation research. Okay. And also, so I think it's already done. And here, macro level and micro level. 18, feature of the action research. You must know this is a feature of action research and benefit of action research practice. So the time is not with me. So and action research and traditional research, what is the difference of action research and traditional research? Know that. 19, this is the last unit, component of research proposal. It's very much important. The feature of research proposal, or what can you do? It contains what? Orientation of research problem, you have to know. Statement of research problem, you must write a statement. Object of the study, you must come up with the objective. Why are you studying? Significant, the main important study. Definition of key, you come up with the key concepts, keywords, then you define them. Preliminary literature review, you must find out, read all what has been published on your topic. Research design and methodology, come up with either you are going to use quantitative research, mixed research, or what so. Research ethics, chapter planning, then you plan your chapter. Chapter 1, what's going to be in chapter 1, what's going to be in chapter 2. Time frame, give your time, then references. References, now where you have obtained information. Research proposal and the structure of thesis. So, dissertation. A research proposal, so what a research proposal and the structure of thesis or dissertation. Know what is research proposal and what is a thesis or dissertation. So main component of research proposal covers, you must a cover letter, and then a project title, general introduction about your topic, a cover letter covering maybe to writing to your supervisor, project title, the title of that your topic, general introduction to your topic, the statement of research problem or research focus, write about the statement of your problems and where your focus on that research is. Explanation of research method and approach, and you must explain which research methodology are you going to use. You are going to use analytic research or qualitative or quantitative research. Evaluation of the ethics of the project and also statement of expected outcome of the project. What do you, the outcome of your research you are expect or your findings? And component of dissertation, your dissertation or thesis, your final one must contain a title page, a copyright page, abstract about what is written in your thesis, committee signature, those maybe your supervisor and those and also those who monitor the opponent of your research. Acknowledgement, you must write, acknowledge people now, maybe who gave you encouragement to write your thesis, or maybe who gave you time and so on. table of content. The table of content now contains chapter 1 and sub chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, and subtopics, list of tables, the tables that contains your data, and list of figures, the diagrams, and you know the diagram and figures that you draw using statistical approach. So the main ones, the final pay attention, exercise or homework, please. This is where through compiling this PowerPoint presentation. So it was a lot of information. Then I discovered out that I should give you easier for you if you can follow this one. Like you should answer the learning activity based on this, like unit one. In the, according to that, you on your study guide, like unit one, that's activity 1.1, page 3. So each unit, I put activity and also where you find that activity on which page. Okay, unit 1, unit 2, up to unit 19. Please do this, follow this, answer this as you learn, as you write your homework, I mean your assignment, and prepare for the examination. Please follow these guides here, exercise or homework. This, even when you are learning, you just come here and go to this kind of activity, so you'll be, it will make you easier to understand. Okay? So there are a lot, up to 2017, 19, okay, like match the description. Is this example of matching in 19.2, page 315, using the study guide. I took this from your study guide. Okay, that is all what we have learned today. And even though, you know, a lot of information, but I was so fast, I couldn't explain every fact, whatever, but I just gave you where you should focus and what you must do. So the main things, the final one I want to tell you, that answer all your, go to your student portal and look at the past question papers, and that's how you prepare for your examination also. But it doesn't mean that we ask the same question paper, but just to see the structure of the examination and try to answer those questions. And also your assignment also. So know your assignment very well. And most of the question, because the exam is also based on, or it reflects on the assignment. So I thank you for paying attention, and I think that you will do well in your April, August, and November examination 2020. I thank you.